Lawrence's high priest men who have weaknesses. We see that quite evident, both then and today. We are subject to the world's different whims and what we see, how we respond to it, but Jesus, unmovable. The law appoints as high priest many of witnesses, but the word of the oath of God, which came after the law, appoints the Son who has been perfected forever. Jesus is unchanging. It says the will of God is unchanging. Hebrews 9, verses 11 through 15. It talks of that the sanctuary of the new covenant. Verse 11, it says, but Christ came as high priest of the good things to come. You know, we live this world, and sometimes this world is kind of crazy right now. But Christ is the high priest of the things that are to come. And as in your life and in my life, don't know what will happen with this country. But I do know that it will all be within God's will. But the greater and more perfect tabernacle not made with hands, that is not of this creation. Remember that the tabernacle as designed by Moses, it was an image of the tabernacle in heaven. It was just a pattern. But Jesus came not with the blood of God, goats and camels, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. It's not just for today or just for tomorrow. It's an eternal redemption. His sacrifice on that cross gave us life eternal. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sacrifice for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? But he offered himself to cleanse us so that we might serve the living God. And for this reason, he is mediator of the new covenant by means of his death for the redemption of transgressions under the first covenant. The law only kept you. It didn't give you forgiveness. It could not redeem you. It would cover you over. It was just a way of that God provided for the nation of Israel so they could come and offer the sacrifice. Those who are called may receive the promise of that eternal inheritance, everlasting life. In Hebrews 9, verses 24 and 28, it says, for Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the truth, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Here is in the presence of God for us, remembering his intercession for us. Continuing. Not that he should offer himself often as the high priest enters the most holy place every year with the blood of another. He then had to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now once at the end of the ages he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. You know, that's another thing that I think about. You know, we tend to get under the law every once in a while. I look at my Amish neighbors now. They can't wear red. They can't play musical instruments. They can't do this and they can't do that. But what I'm thankful for is what I can do. What I can do in the kingdom of God. what I can do with each, every person that I come in contact with, that I can share Christ, that I can speak openly. That it's not, I don't get judged by what I eat or what I wear. I get judged by my relationship with Jesus Christ, whether I have received him or not. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ has offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin and crucifixion. Hebrews 10:8 through 23. This new covenant, assured by Christ's shed blood in his death. Jesus spoke previously, saying, sacrifice and offerings, burnt offerings and offerings to sin, you did not desire nor had pleasure in them, which were offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I have come to do your will, God. He came to do the will of God, to be obedient, to come, to share the kingdom of God, and then to go to the cross. Take our sins upon himself, not just for that day, but forever. No. Behold, I have come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. By that will, God's will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And we see too many people that think that, you know, they want to put Christ back on that cross. He's not going back up there. He's now sitting, as it says, at the right hand of God the Father. It says that in another book, it says that he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. But right now, he's interceding for all of us, bringing us before God. Every priest stands, you know, in this course, think about the Old Testament, stand daily, offering repeatedly the same sacrifice which could never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. And I just thank God that when God looks at me, he sees Jesus. Because I'm still walking that walk. I'm still in that walk of sanctification. He sees me as complete. I know that I am not in this walk. But before him I am. It says, but the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them, he adds. And then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. I have a habit of saying myself, I forgive you, but I'm going to remember what you did. I thought I was doing pretty good by forgiving. But I think there's a point in time where we need to forget. I mean, it can make our life easier. about the other person, but it will make our life easier, because if we don't hold a grudge against somebody or expect somebody to do something that offends us, then we don't have to worry about it. We can lead a much simpler life, easier. You know, I, 30 years that I spent in law enforcement as sheriff, you know, I knew where the problems were going to be, and I knew that, you know, this, I could say in my mind, okay, this person, when he gets out of jail, it's not going to be long and he'll be back again. But God says, I'll remember no more. God didn't make us to be fools. No, we have a mind to think about things. We don't put ourselves in positions that cause, that we know will cause trouble. And we need to forgive and forget. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new living way which he consecrated for us, through that veil. Remember, Matthew 27, verse 51 tells us that when Christ died on that cross, that the veil was ripped from top to bottom, which opens the way for us to enter into that personal place with God. So we can come boldly before him in prayer, supplication, thanksgiving, in worship. And then it says, that is his flesh. And that was symbolic of the temple being torn from the top. That he offered up his own body, his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water of the Word. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he promised his faith. God is faithful. He does not waver. He has not changed. He is who we have always been. So, every day, no matter what's going on in our lives, we have bad knees. Maybe we have family members that are in trouble, sick. Maybe we have financial, social, political, world problems. I'm going to still hold fast the confession of our hope without waiting for his promises. He is faithful. As Joan said, read one of the promises this morning, he is faithful to us. All of the promises in his word. We can receive them. We can walk in them. And that is how we are. We should live our lives as redeemed children, perfected children of God. It is, as I said, that the foundational truth that we have. We want to make sure that we are anchored in that. And then we continue to move up and receive more and more of what God has for us. More and more of what the Spirit will lead us into. And then we need to be willing to act upon what the Spirit leads us to. Amen.
Amen.
And we'll close with the blessing that we find in Numbers chapter 6. Does the Lord bless you and keep you? The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.